So, guten Abend, sehr verehrte Damen und
Good
Herren,
evening, ladies and gentlemen, dear Professor Gross, dear Professor Kornas, dear viewers at home at your screens. I would like to welcome you very cordially to the virtual space of our W. Michael Blumenthal Academy of the Jewish Museum in Berlin. So, especially in times of crisis, when fronts harden and people act irrationally, as Moses Mendelssohn said, it is more important than ever to look beyond your own horizon. So, in our dialogical lecture series, Kosher to Go, we literally look at different plates and into different pots and far beyond. Examining perspectives on religious dietary rules in the context of their origins and development, in the context of other religions and societies, and how they are applied in light of current developments. David Kramer and Kikuko Kashiwagi-Wetzel kicked things off 2 weeks ago with Why Do Dietary Rules Exist? All talks will be available on the museum's website later. So during the next sessions, we will explore the status of alcohol in Judaism and Christianity, the relationship to animals in Judaism and Hinduism, and finally, dietary rules in the light of ecology and modern debates about food. For tonight's event, Kosher and Halal, I turn the floor over to my colleague Shlomit Tripp. She's the director of community programs at the Academy, who will welcome our guests and walk you through this evening. Have a great session.
Ja, auch meinerseits. Guten Abend.
Well, yes. Thank you very much, and good evening also from me. So today's dialogical lecture is about a current topic prominent in European media and the courts, ritual slaughtering in Judaism and Islam. The European Court of Justice discussed the balancing act between animal rights and the right to religious freedom in a tolerant, pluralistic society. And in the year 2020, the ruling was made that ritual slaughter may be banned in European countries. So we will not be discussing European legislation tonight, but would like to hear from our guests today what religious scholars of the two religions have to say about ritual slaughtering, where there are similarities, where the two religions differ. Before we start introducing our guests, well, we would like to provide some technical information for all our viewers. The event will be held in German and English with simultaneous interpretation. After the two input statements, we will move on to our panel discussion. So you, our viewers, will have the opportunity to participate by asking your question in German or English on Slido. So you can find the link to Slido on our homepage for this event, or you can go directly to the website, the www.slido.com, or you can also download the free Slido app via your app store. You would then enter the event code, which is 048819. So this information will be displayed again and again during the show. That said, let me now introduce our guests tonight, and I'll start with Aaron Saul Gross. He's a professor of theology and religious studies at the University of San Diego, and he's the author of The Question of a book called Animal and Religion, Theoretical Stakes, Practical Implications. He is the founder of Farm Forward, a not-for-profit advocacy organization that aims to raise awareness about the ethical aspects of food, reduce farm animal suffering, and promote sustainable agriculture.
Serdar
Kurnas is a professor of Islamic law in history and the present at the Berlin Institute for Islamic Theology at Humboldt University in Berlin. From 2016 to 2019, he was an assistant professor of Islamic theology at the Academy of World Religions at the University of Hamburg. His areas of specialization include Islamic legal methodology and Islamic ethics. So, Professor Aaron Gross, the stage, or rather the screen, is yours.
Wonderful. It's wonderful to be here this evening. I've been invited to speak to you about shechita, the method of animal slaughter prescribed by traditional Jewish law. Can we put up the slides? So I've been asked you to speak to you about shechita. To clarify, eating meat is not required in Judaism, but if you do choose to eat animals, there is a prescribed method of slaughter, and that is shechita. My remarks today will primarily be kind of explanatory and descriptive, with an aim of helping you understand what shechita is, and in particular, speaking to how it is that shechita came to be connected with animal welfare concerns, and see if I can clarify that nexus. To begin with my conclusion, what I'll be arguing is that once we understand what shechita is, we will see that there isn't any kind of hard conflict between shechita and animal welfare. Instead, what I will argue is that we have a conflict between industrialized animal slaughter and animal welfare, and that with anti-Semitism in the mix, shechita and halal get kind of a bad reputation, perhaps we should say, in this context unfairly. So let me begin.
Der Dolmetscherin, der Ton ist weg.
Professor Gross, your sound is gone. Ist weg. Your sound
have
is
I,
gone.
Have I come back?
Now you're back
have
on.
I come back?
Jetzt ist der Ton wieder da. Sie können
folgen. So shechita, to describe what shechita is, I apologize about the sound glitch, is killing an animal by a precise cut to the neck that induces blood loss. That's my best attempt to describe in simple terms what shechita is. Now, Jewish law will be concerned with several aspects of shechita. It will be regulating who is allowed to slaughter. It will be regulating the equipment, the knife that is used. It will be regulating the health of the animal at the time slaughter occurs. Most obviously, the actual cut itself, and then Jewish law concerns itself with the inspection afterwards. Now, it is in the way Jewish law looks at this question of the health of the animal at the moment the cut is performed that leads to much of the controversy connected with animal welfare. Because we have a requirement here in Jewish law that animals must be healthy and therefore conscious at the moment their throat is cut, at the moment shechita is performed. And it is that provision which will ultimately lead to conflict with animal welfare, but really this occurs after the rise of industrial slaughter. That was my attempt to give you a really quick description of shechita. Before I move forward, though, I want to bring in a rabbinic voice so that you can hear how shechita might be described in a slightly different accent. This is Rabbi Appel writing in the Concise Code of Jewish Law from a modern Orthodox perspective. Shechita must be done by means of a swift, smooth cut of a sharp knife whose blade is free of any dent or imperfection. Shechita entails severing the trachea and the esophagus in accordance with the oral tradition. And the oral tradition he is referring to there is the tradition of Jewish law stemming from the rabbis and located especially in the Talmud. And that oral tradition requires that five improper procedures be avoided lest they invalidate the shechita and render the animal unfit to be eaten. Now, if we were in a more traditional context, if we were training to learn how to actually do shechita, these five improper procedures would become the focus of our discussion. I'm only going to list them briefly here. So the person performing the slaughter must avoid hesitation or delay while drawing the knife, must avoid excessive pressure, must avoid burrowing, must make the decision inside the specified area, and must avoid lacerating or tearing the trachea or the esophagus. And each of these five provisions would be expanded in the training for traditional Jewish slaughter. So moving from the what to the purpose, it is not an easy or simple question to answer. What is the purpose of these laws? I'm going to relate two answers that we have in Jewish tradition. The first argues that the Jewish dietary laws, the kosher laws in general, are simply beyond rational comprehension. The argument here is that many of the traditional Jewish laws are rational, are ethical in nature, and we can reason them out. So the laws that deal with honesty, that deal with not stealing, we can say those are rational laws. But the rabbis speculate that perhaps the kosher laws are not in that category. They are something we are simply not meant to understand. This can be a very unsatisfying explanation, but happily there is another one, especially prominent in German Jewry, which has emphasized that the purpose of the laws of Shechita are to reduce animal suffering, that their purpose is in fact compassion for animals. So especially given that one of the traditional explanations for the purpose of Shechita is animal welfare, how did we end up with a conflict? My answer is that this is a product of modernization. So as slaughter modernizes and becomes centralized and industrialized, new welfare problems emerge. It is in response to these new welfare problems that stunning is proposed as a solution. So it is in the process of moving from small-scale traditional slaughter, like you see depicted in the painting I have on the screen, to industrial slaughter, that stunning becomes such an important vehicle to achieve animal welfare. Now, the central conflict with Shechita is rooted in the very serious welfare problems that can arise when industrial slaughter systems that are designed to work with stunned animals are used for fully conscious animals without sufficient modification. The problem that occurred both in the US and in places throughout Europe was the development of industrial slaughterhouses that assumed the animal was going to be unconscious throughout the process because they were stunned right at the beginning of the process. And that stunning itself was introduced because of humane advocacy. But as it was introduced, the systems became designed to depend on it. Now, unsurprisingly, if you have a system which assumes that an animal is being rendered unconscious right at the beginning of the process, and in order to accommodate religious slaughter, you simply remove the stunning and leave everything else exactly the same, you're going to have very serious welfare problems. You can't simply remove stunning from a system designed for it and expect the result to be good. So how does the history of anti-Semitism factor into this. So I've argued there is a real set of problems that emerge because of industrialization, but that shechita itself, that is the requirement not to stun, is not itself the issue. Let me now say a little bit about the history of how shechita becomes associated with anti-Semitism. Through the mid-1800s and early 1900s, we see rising anti-Semitism throughout the European context. And this is where anti-Shechita activity first starts to appear prominently. By the early 1900s, German veterinarians in particular have formulated a scientific style critique of Shechita. Though it is couched in the language of science, it's fairly openly anti-Semitic. What I mean by that is the language describes Shechita as inherently anti-modern and barbarous. It doesn't take a lot of analysis looking at these texts to see that they have an agenda that goes beyond animal welfare. Now, in the US context, humane advocates actually adopt this framing, often citing German scientists. This would be in the 1920s in the US context. By the mid-1920s, the Nazi Party in Germany aligns itself with anti-Shechita, and when they come to power, they ban Shechita, and this leaves a fairly indelible impression on the Jewish community. Post-World War II, we see a significant divergence in how this conversation unfolds in the US and in the European context. In the US in the 1950s, humane legislation is passed to reform slaughter, but with full support from the Jewish community. So quite a different context than happened in Nazism. Kosher slaughter in the US context is defined as humane, and as the process moves forward, there continue to be concerns about some kosher slaughter, but there are no further attacks on Shechita. In the European context, by contrast, Shechita remains more ambivalent.
I think, you know, we had a crash, so yeah, technological miracles here. So can we simply continue? This is my question to the technical team. Yes, we can. So please continue, Professor Gross.
Wonderful. So I apologize for the technical issues. So I was giving you a little bit of a history of Shechita's ties with, or anti-Shechita's ties with anti-Semitism, anti-Shechita's ties with anti-Semitism, and now just mentioning briefly where we've kind of ended up. So the EU requires stun slaughter, but allows for this possibility of exceptions for religious slaughter. So we have diverse responses across different countries. So several countries simply do not allow derogations from the general requirement for stunning, rendering kosher and halal slaughter in those countries functionally illegal. Other countries are requiring a post-cut stun. So this is not formally a problem in Jewish law, that is, stunning after the animal. At least I should say, in many cases, it is not a problem. So this is an attempt to find a solution. And other countries, including Germany, permit derogations. What I want to emphasize is that stunning is not the only way to reduce animal suffering. So the root problem is how to manage the welfare limitations created by industrialized slaughter, not religious slaughter itself. And this position is the one advocated by Dr. Temple Grandin. For those who are not familiar with Dr. Grandin, she enjoys an unusual status among animal welfare scientists, somebody who is highly respected both by animal welfare advocates, really even animal rights advocates rely on her, and who has won the respect of the Jewish community for her work on kosher slaughter. And she really insists that the issue is handling more than stunning, and that with the proper handling of the animals, which of course requires a system that is not dependent on stunning to achieve welfare, you can achieve extremely high welfare in a kosher system. The bottom line for Dr. Grandin's perspective and from the perspective I would advocate would be to look at the experience of the animal from the exit of the farm until loss of consciousness, that whole experience the animal has. A narrow focus on the very moment of slaughter and the question of stunning seems to be a product of other motivations. So is there a conflict between animal welfare and shechita? I'm arguing that there is not, but that there is a conflict between industrialized slaughter and animal welfare. So to the extent kosher slaughter becomes industrialized, which it is, we do have concerns we need to address. Some kosher slaughter plants are very problematic. It's just not because of shechita. So the fuller answer here is no, there's not a hard conflict between animal welfare and shechita, but there can be a conflict between animal welfare and the interests of kosher meat producers in lowering costs. Higher welfare kosher slaughter will inevitably be more expensive. The kind of handling required to achieve high welfare in this system is more expensive than in a stunning system. And so it's here where I think the state legitimately has an interest in protecting animals. The main threat to animal welfare, however, is economically, not culturally or religiously incentivized cruelty. Animal welfare is best advanced, I would argue, by avoiding unnecessary attacks on religious slaughter. And in fact, Jewish traditions can really be allies in this work. I do work with a group called the Jewish Initiative for Animals, which works in this very nexus. I apologize for the technical problems. Those are my remarks. Thank you.
Yeah. Vielen Dank, Professor Gross.
Well, thank you so very much, Professor Gross, for your lecture. I do hope that you all see me now. Yes, that seems to be the case. So thank you, Professor Gross, for your lecture, through which we got the scientific insight into a Jewish perspective on the subject. So we'll move on now directly to the lecture of Professor Kurnas. He will give us an insight into the topic of slaughtering from the perspective of Islamic law. You have the floor, Professor.
Vielen Dank. Ganz herzlichen Dank für die Einladung.
Thank you very much indeed. Thank you for your invitation. I'm very happy to be here. And thank you also very much to Professor Gross for this wonderful presentation. As a matter of fact, the viewers will probably see that I'm going to say very similar things, because there are very many similar ideas that I would like to put forth. And the Islamic tradition also holds that you can, if you want to eat meat, you don't have to. For those of you who might not be very familiar with the Islamic tradition, I would like to tell you a little bit more about the Islamic context. So it's not only about ritual slaughtering in Islamic tradition, but the context in which this is being discussed. I'm going to talk about that. And then afterwards, talking a little bit more about the position of ritual slaughtering. So here is my PowerPoint presentation. Thank you very much. So why do we actually talk about this and discuss this in Islamic law? Some people might hold, why would we call this a law? This is done for historical reason. We are not only talking about civil laws and criminal laws, but Islamic law addresses acts of worship and interpersonal relations. So this has something to do with, for example, performing the obligatory prayer, paying the alms tax, or fasting, as recently done during Ramadan. So Islamic law is considered to be a place where correct behavior in everyday life is being discussed. So this includes also the regulations on what is clean and what is unclean, and on dietary rules. Islamic law also considers the circumstances under which special types of food may be consumed. And basically, we can say that according to Islamic law, the principle applies that you're allowed to do or consume everything as long as it has not been prohibited. As long as the opposite has not been proven to hold true. So we use the Quran, the Sunnah, the two religious sources in Islam, and we find information on what Muslims are not allowed to eat or drink in these two religious texts. So these texts contain reports, and if we say, okay, in these two religious texts, no particular mention is made of XYZ, then it is allowed to, for example, eat or drink a particular food or beverage.
Damit steht eigentlich fest, dass der dass die Einschränkung vom
Konsum von this also then means that any restrictions in the consumption of food are based on the religious texts, and we relate especially to Surah 6:145. I have put it on my slide here, and here it's states that the surah states, I do not find it in what has been revealed to me anything forbidden for anyone who wants to eat, unless it is carrion, outpoured blood, and the flesh of swine, all of which is unclean, or that which is profane, having been slaughtered in a name other than that of Allah. So, on the other hand, it also stipulates that if there is an emergency, then you might also be able, and you are allowed then, to actually eat foods that under other conditions would not be allowed to be eaten. But this is just in case of an emergency. There are reasons for these bans that we find in the religious texts. Impure things must not be consumed. So, for example, dogs are considered to be impure. And then the other principle that I talked about before is anything that has been sacrificed for any deity other than God must not be consumed. So, actually, when doing ritual slaughtering, it has to be done in the name of the God of Allah, and this then means ritual slaughtering is what we will concentrate on here. So impure things must not be consumed, we said, and it has to be done if ritual slaughtering or slaughtering has to be done in the name of God. So I would like to take up two questions in my presentation. In Islamic law, what is considered to be unclean? That is one question, the first one, and then the second one, how precisely must animals be slaughtered for Muslims to be allowed to eat meat? So basically, we can actually say this. In Islamic law, as a matter of principle, the consumption of unclean things is forbidden. So this is actually also what Professor Gross said. This is the same in Islamic law. If we are talking about rituals, then we don't have to look for a rational reason behind it all. No, it might be an arbitrary thing that God said, all right, dog meat is unclean, pork is unclean, predatory animals meat is unclean.
Herdentieren erlaubt, Ziegen, Kühe, Büffel, Kamele, die werden
Buffaloes, camels, etc. There are these types of animals that are allowed to be eaten, then also goats, etc. But there is one other principle I would like to mention here is that what must not be eaten or is impure must also not be sold. Pork, predatory birds, donkeys, toxic animals, insects, snakes, also rabbit meat in accordance with the Shiite tradition, and carrion must not be eaten. So these are the things that goes hand in hand with the obligation to do ritual slaughtering, because you have to guarantee that if you, for example, slaughter a cow, the animal must still be alive. So a captive bull stunning, for example, might lead to a situation where that this animal dies before it's being slaughtered, and then it must not be eaten. It's not allowed to be eaten. So if adequate slaughtering is not given, then the meat is unfit for consumption. If a dog, if an animal, a dog, a predatory animal, etc., is not clean, then also the individual parts are not considered to be clean. So bristles, for example, or all of these components that are used for clothing, for brushes, or pork gelatin, for example, for sweets, etc., can also or must also not be eaten or used. So if the decision is being made that something is not pure, then the consequences are large.
But
I will not go into that more in detail, but I will focus on ritual slaughtering. So what about ritual slaughtering? How does that, or is that being done? And I think this is very similar to what we heard about the Jewish tradition. So forms of ritual slaughtering, the most important way of ritual slaughtering, conducting it, is the severing of the trachea and the esophagus. When doing ritual slaughtering, basically this means that the meat is being made fit for human consumption. There is another way of ritual slaughtering, which is sticking the knife into the chest. That's the sticking point that is important, and this is done with certain animals, for example, camels and also fowl. With fowl, you are also not allowed to actually sever the complete head, but the head should still be linked to the neck. This is something that we find in the modern sources, but the classical sources don't have anything to say on that point. The procedure as such, very important in this regard, is that you invoke the Basmala in the name of the most gracious, the most merciful. This is what you invoke, and most of the Muslims believe that this is an obligation. It's a must to do so when doing ritual slaughtering. There are many scholars that are discussing whether during ritual slaughter you can do without the invocation of the Basmala. But as we said before, ritual slaughtering must be done in the name of Allah. And therefore, the invocation seems to be a very important and key issue. It has to be ruled out that this animal is sacrificed in the name of another deity, which means that people need to be made aware that if an animal is slaughtered, it is done for and on behalf and for the benefit of the human being. And this is why the suffering of the animal has to be minimized. So, you know, you have to have a proper knife, a very sharp knife, so you don't cut two or three or four times. No, you have to have the proper tools to reduce the suffering of the animal. The ritual slaughterer has to be aware that the suffering of the animal has to be kept at a minimum. There are detailed discussions on that point. For example, during the Feast of the Sacrifice, how to actually do with the animals. Maybe, you know, the other animals should be turned, or the heads of these animals should be turned, you know, with their eyes elsewhere, not to where the other animals are being slaughtered at that particular moment. And so all of this is actually being considered. So actually, ritual slaughtering we do not consider to be the problem, but it is animal welfare and it is animal husbandry that might provide a problem, which was mentioned before. So Muslims, especially in European countries, there is a problem. Namely, many European countries hold that stunning is a must. For example, in France and the Netherlands. This is the case, even though I believe in the Netherlands some of the legal provisions have changed. In Spain, for example, ritual slaughtering is allowed without prior stunning. This is different in Germany. But normal ritual slaughtering may be conducted, but in Germany, normally stunning has to be applied. So there are lots of discussions among Muslim scholars in Europe, also including Turkey. Many of them hold that stunning is possible because the animal is still alive, even though there are measuring devices applied to see whether the animal is still alive. That holds true for the captive bull, stunning as well. So controls are necessary. So, for example, you also take a look at the eyes to see whether there are still signs of life in the animal's body, in order to find out whether this is, after stunning, an animal that's already dead or still alive. So many Muslim scholars also now insist on not continuing the stunning, and they argue that the animal actually suffers less when doing ritual slaughtering right away without prior stunning, with electroshock or with the captive bolt shot. So they are trying to find the pain, the degree of pain that is applied to the animal, and to reduce that pain. That is the ultimate goal. So when we are talking about France, there are French Muslims that insist that meat needs to be of high quality, and ritual slaughtering means that meat is produced that is of higher quality than other meat. And so this is an argument that they put forth, even though there is also a major trend saying, okay, no, it is not the ritual slaughtering that really provides the problem to the animal, but the kind of animal husbandry, industrialized mass production, that provides the problem and presents the problem. So, for example, in the morning, let's say the basmala is being invoked, then a machine is being switched on, and then one animal after the other is being killed. So this is also a process that can be seen sometimes, and that, of course, would not correspond to ritual slaughtering, the traditional rituals, kind of ritual slaughtering that we have in mind. So then what they do is just say the and recite the basmala one time and only one time, but that reduces the respect for the animal, because after all, you're extinguishing the life of the animal in that moment, and that makes the animal more of an object and not as the animal, the animal that sacrifices its body. So the consumption of the meat of animals slaughtered by non-Muslims is another issue that is controversial, and there are conflicting interests here. Well, slaughtering in Europe, or ritual slaughtering, as I mentioned before, in Europe is difficult in some countries, at least, for example, Germany, and therefore many or a lot of meat actually is imported to Germany from the Netherlands or other countries, but also from New Zealand, Australia, where there are other rules that apply, even though in these countries there's also electroshock that is most often permitted. So, Islamic scholars do talk a lot and discuss the invocation of the basmala, and they refer to Surah 5:5. Which states that today all good, pure foods have been made lawful for you. Similarly, the food of the people of the book is permissible for you, and yours is permissible for them. So this is then another round of discussion that is a difficult issue to be argued and to be decided upon, because the consumption of the meat of animal slaughtered by non-Muslims, is it lawful for eating or is it unfit for human consumption? So this is a discussion that actually led to a question that was raised, well, is it actually necessary to really invoke the Basmala, the name of the Allah, if this is an atheist doing slaughtering and then the meat is fully, or the animal is fully bled, then isn't that halal meat after all? And there are scholars saying no, that is not the case. It has to be a Muslim actually doing the ritual slaughtering, and only then is the meat fit for human consumption and lawful. However, in Germany, we can observe that German, a religious German companies actually also provide halal certificates to meat after producing that meat in a particular manner for Muslims to be able to buy it. Now, as to the principles behind ritual slaughtering, well, the majority of the rules come from the rules and regulations on sacrifice, especially relating to the festivity of the sacrifice. Actually, we are discussing animal welfare or animal ethics topics in this regard. In principle, we can say that in case of ritual slaughtering or the sacrifice of the animal, actually, you know, this is always a whole Holy day, it's the 10th day during the festivities, the period of festivities, then, you know, the animal can be slaughtered, can be sacrificed, can be provided to the poor people, to the people in need. That is possible, but it's not a must. And what holds true for ritual slaughtering and what is the basic of it all is that, of course, you know, that the animal must not suffer, must be healthy, and this holds true for sacrifices as well. For camels, you have other rules, you know, they have to be at least 5 years old, 2 years old, etc. All of this is being discussed in the Muslim tradition, and that is then, you know, the discussion on regular slaughtering. As you can see, there is not, you know, a kind of a tradition that says, okay, you do slaughtering one after the other. No, you have not this one set of rules that applies all the time, but you keep on thinking on the particular situation in which slaughtering is taking place. And so this also then leads to a situation in which people are trying to come up with some rational grounds, as, for example, okay, you do not eat and you must not eat carrion because the animal is dead, and the animal should not be dead because this is, you know, the rules, that's the dietary rules that we want to adhere to. Now, I mentioned certification of meat as halal meat before very briefly, and of course, on an international level, this is to be seen more and more often because Muslims, of course, are traveling the world, and then when they come to Germany, for example, and they are here as second or third generation Muslims, well, they are thinking in terms of, okay, well, we are not a minority anymore, we are part of the majority, and so how can we actually come up with our certification or the certificates that we need. And there is a list of certificates that do exist on an international level in Germany, etc. So there are certificates that the scholars try to uphold for people to orient themselves at. So the international and the German certificates normally are geared towards the ideas expressed by the scholars of the Gulf states, but there are the Turkish scholars and the Malaysian scholars. There is competition among some of them, and of course the certificates or certification has also become a business, and it's quite expensive to get a certificate. So that plays a role too. You do see the different types of certificates and the certification models that we have for halal meat. And if you take a look at all of these certificates, you might think, well, maybe, you know, the awareness has been raised among Muslims also in terms of, you know, the religious backdrop of slaughtering. But actually, that's not the case. Yes, we do have a lot of these certificates, but it's also, as I said, about like the competition. Who interprets or has the power to actually interpret what halal meat is? But for example, Turkey was not interested in cooperating more at the European level because they wanted to cooperate with Malaysia. So it is very important to understand that, you know, religion is being taken as a starting point to really come up with some power to interpret what halal is and what the dietary rules are. There are also the organic procedures. So, for example, there is a modern type of animal welfare, and of course people also criticize then what they consider to be you know, slaughtering that is not, or that is in opposition to organic farming or the type of animal husbandry that is not admitted. But last but not least, and very briefly, at the very end of my presentation, let me give you an outlook of veganism and vegetarianism, because animal welfare concerns are taken as a reason, of course, to turn veganism and vegetarianism by some scientists, you know, to turn to these new trends. And these scientists actually also state that, well, it isn't since the 1960s, for example, there is the movement to actually turn the Muslim community to become more in favor of, you know, vegetarianism, veganism, and there are other movements, however, the group Green Dean, for example, that simply says, well, you know, meat consumption should be lowered to begin with. These are modern movements, but there are also other mystic traditions, Islamic mystics, for example, that already started earlier, like in the 16th or 17th century, that said, okay, well, we have to lower meat consumption, we want to protect the animal, we want a holistic system to adhere to, and we don't want to kill animals because it's the extinguishing of the life of the animal, and so we have to also be very careful in this regard. And so actually, therefore, we can say traditionally, but also in modern times, we have this argument for lower meat consumption. but we also try and include all of this basically also in our ritual slaughtering
procedure
as described. Thank you.
Vorträge, die so viele Parallelen, aber auch einige Unterschiede.
Well, thank you very much, Professor Kornas. I think these were two very interesting lectures because you show so many parallels, but also differences in the two religions. So before we continue with the dialogical part, I would like to invite the audience again to ask their questions to today's speakers. Actually, we have already received quite a number of questions. So let me therefore say that we will not be able to answer all of them. We will have to select some of them. But let me give you these technical information again. So you can either click directly on the link on our homepage if you want to raise your question or ask questions via www.slido.com. Or you can download Slido via your App Store. And here you do see the event code that is being displayed at the moment. Well, actually, I believe that some of the questions have already been raised and answered during the presentations. So this is why I would like to maybe concentrate on those questions that have not yet been answered fully. So let me start with this first question. Professor Kornas actually talked about halal products being certified. Professor Gross, so what is kosher for some is not kosher for others. So how do you explain the different kosher certificates of glatt kosher, chersher, tzedek, kosher lemeradrin, and taf sheverativ maybe, and which Jewish communities promote these certificates?
Yeah, thanks so much for the question. So indeed, what kosher means is diverse, and this can be traced to particular communities. That is, there may be traditions that that kind of originated in German Jewry, certain details of how slaughter is done, or other aspects of kosher practice. So you can have traditions that originally belong to a particular kind of region, and then so, for example, in the U.S., where Ashkenazi Jewry, that is kind of a German, Austrian Jewry, is dominant. That is, most American Jews have that as their origin. So you have particular features of German kosher traditions becoming, you know, dominant in the country as a whole. So the case of what was referred to as glatt kosher has to do with a stringency. That is, there's a general understanding of what's required for meat to count as kosher. And then you have certain rabbis saying, but in addition to the general agreement about what is required, I have an additional stringency. And so glatt is a very technical stringency that has to do with lesions on the lung during the inspection. Ultimately, it should be an indicator of the overall health of an animal. And that's an example of a stringency in kosher law, which eventually became, in the U.S. context, it has become almost standard. That is, pretty much all slaughter of cows today is going to be, in the U.S., glatt kosher. Now, glatt isn't a certification, it's describing a particular legal stringency. So you have these differences in practices, that's one difference, and then you have different agencies doing the certification. And the question named really a third phenomena, which is, in addition to there being certification agencies that are putting a mark on the product and verifying that kosher laws were followed, you now have groups that are saying, well, beyond the legal concerns, we are wanting to address ethical concerns, how the workers were treated, how the animals were treated, and have this as something that goes beyond, explicitly goes beyond kosher law, goes beyond the laws of Shechita, but yet might be something Jewish consumers are looking for. So what this complicated landscape I've tried to briefly describe shows us is these different intra-Jewish communities trying to articulate different values and tie them with different kosher practices. And that has to do with the whole range of things from, if you will, commitment to certain kind of folk traditions to concern with kind of, you know, cutting edge ethical issues and how to integrate dietary practice with those issues. So there's much that could be said about the certification landscape, but hopefully that's a useful orientation.
Ja, wenn wir bei der Orientierung sind.
Yes, thank you very much. So, talking about orientation. Well, I am orienting myself at another question, namely that of domestic slaughtering, because really that is an important topic. Professor Kornas, I would like to address you directly. In Western countries, we can say there is a new trend in Western countries, namely slaughtering the animals on your own farm. This is quite the rule in many Muslim countries, right? So some families slaughter their own animals before the Feast of Sacrifice. However, sometimes also without official authorization and right in the middle of large cities. Now, in Europe, domestic slaughtering comes with very strict official rules. And therefore, this practice is often perceived as disconcerting, which also has to do, of course, with the way the animals are kept. So what do you say about this type of practice and also the concerns that were raised? And also, one more question. According to Muslim rules, may every Muslim man or woman slaughter an animal, or are there certain guidelines to follow? Yeah, very important and interesting question. It's just as you described. I've seen that in Turkey, in Syria, in Cairo, in Egypt, in general. I've seen these slaughters being done actually right in the middle of the street. There are very strict opinions on, well, what is halal and what is not halal. Actually, during the Feast of Sacrifice, well, you have to do the slaughtering, the ritual slaughtering yourself. There are people who hold that this is a must. Now, should that be done by males or females, or should it be done only by men? This is always a question that is being discussed, but, you know, it has to be a person, you know, not a teenager anymore, but of a certain age and legally responsible. And so some scholars hold it should only be done by men, but as a matter of fact, this is not, you know, 100% of the people who, of the scholars who say so. Domestic slaughtering is done more flexibly in some of the countries, unlike what you see in Europe. But it has to be, you know, a qualified type of slaughtering, and it should be subject to authorization as well, because what you do need is a certain type of experience. Not everybody should simply go on on with the slaughtering, so also, you know, in case of the feast of sacrifice. So not every man should actually be able to do this type of ritual slaughtering. So the person who's actually doing the slaughtering on the farm, and if, you know, the animal comes maybe from industrial production, it's basically an animal that is then liberated from that life. And so that could be also an animal that would be slaughtered. Well, okay. But I think, and I would hold that a mini certificate should actually also be provided, you know, the authorization, because otherwise this type of domestic slaughtering might lead to more suffering to the animal. Because, as I said before, somebody needs a certain type of experience before slaughtering is being done. And how do you get that experience? Not in front of a simulator. Yeah, you have to do it yourself. So therefore, I think it is important to have certain checks and controls put in place. Professor Gross, what about jewelry? Is every Jew and every Jewess allowed to ritually slaughter an animal? So, males and females alike? And does Judaism actually also allow domestic slaughtering?
Yeah, so traditionally the slaughterer is to be a man and is to have a certain amount of training. As far as I'm aware, that is the standard practice in any of the kosher kind of slaughter facilities I know. So it would all be traditionally observant Jewish men. A bit of background that might be useful in kind of making sense of this. So we have a wide variety of approaches to traditional Jewish law. And one of the things that's challenging about a discussion like this, where we're discussing dietary law, laws about slaughter, is we don't necessarily have an understanding of this entire system that's governing it. So the range of views within Judaism as to what Jewish law is are enormously diverse. So you'll have folks who are following traditions that were already robust in the medieval period and are being continued into the present through scholarship and the kinds of decisions and conclusions that come out of that process that's attempting to stay as close as possible to these historical legal procedures looks a particular way. At the other end of the Jewish community, and this would be the majority of Jews globally, there's no commitment to traditional Jewish law in practice. There is the understanding that Jewish law is there, but I'm not necessarily observing it, either because I consider myself secularly Jewish, or I consider myself a religious Jew, but my understanding of Jewish law says that there's a kind of critique of the traditional process. And this is, I'm really articulating the beginning of Reform Judaism, that challenges some of the more traditional ways in which law is made. And ultimately, the Reform Jewish tradition insists on personal autonomy. So the law as traditionally understood in Judaism is rejected by a large portion of contemporary Jews. Now, let me return to the specific question about who is allowed to slaughter. So I answered the question from the perspective of kind of Orthodox Jewry in the contemporary moment. But if I go beyond the forms of Jewry that are committed to Jewish law as it's interpreted in the Orthodox space, if I look at the conservative movement, which is a Jewish religious movement, which still understands itself to be tied to traditional halakha, but has a different interpretive tradition. Or if I move to, say, Reform Judaism, where there is a kind of rejection of a kind of rabbinic authority that can supersede individual authority, then the question of who can slaughter would be answered completely differently. So the only answer I can really give in a short period of time is to say traditionally it had to be men and men who were observant. And then in terms of this, the issue of slaughter outside of a slaughterhouse process, I would presume it is allowed by Jewish law if it is legal in that particular state. There would be a Jewish provision that you're supposed to follow the laws of the state that you're in. But I haven't heard of this as a movement, as a kind of large scale phenomena. So I can't say much about it.
Mm-hmm. Ich muss noch einmal nachhaken.
All right. Let me follow up on that. Because we already heard that sometimes you don't find any rational answers. But I'm a woman, and so I have to ask this. Is there a reason why in traditional Jewry, actually women are not allowed to do ritual slaughtering?
Yeah, so thank you for the question. And I'm glad that I spent a moment to indicate that there are these different kind of responses to Jewish law. So the attitudes towards gender are one of the areas where you see the most dramatic transformation. So traditional Judaism, like traditional Christianity and traditional Islam, I would say is a fully patriarchal tradition. The basic picture of the world is of a kind of household that is controlled by a man, and then other folks have various kinds of authority, but there is this very very simply in Christian and Jewish and Muslim law is made entirely by men traditionally. So I wouldn't be able to offer you a specialized reason that women are prohibited from slaughter that's different from the general question of kind of a patriarchy. So in most Jewish movements today, there is a systematic critique of this history of only allowing men to be in positions of authority, and that would be a very robust discussion to get into. But fundamentally, my answer would be that the restriction of essentially becoming a professional slaughterer is an access to a job and a profession, a way of making a living. That would be the cost of denying it to women would be prohibiting that kind of vehicle. Or we could also say if one was motivated to do it for personal reasons. And I would simply say, yeah, this is a limitation on women's authority and power, which is bound up in a larger patriarchal structure. And that there are very good reasons to, move beyond this that wouldn't be specific to Judaism. That would be the broader kind of critiques that feminists have, made of patriarchal traditions. So certainly in, we don't have a big... We don't have a big movement in the U.S. of women expressing an interest in kosher, in becoming shochtim, in being involved in slaughter. But with other practices that have traditionally been denied women, you have rather robust movements of reclaiming them. And in some rabbinical schools, the majority of rabbis now being ordained are women. So this would be a matter where it's a matter of which Judaism we pick up. If we pick up contemporary forms of Judaism engaged with feminism, they would give you an answer similar to the one I gave you. The restriction is essentially sexist and can be overcome. If you turn to folks who have more traditional commitments than I do, you would get a different explanation, of course.
Okay. Da passt ja fast der Spruch drei, nein,
Okay.
Zwei Juden und drei Meinungen.
So, two Jews and three opinions, huh? So. So, obviously, this is something that you also hear in the United States, but we do have the saying here. Now, I also have a very interesting question from one of our viewers. And I would like to take that on. Jews and Muslims, are they allowed to actually eat the blood of fish, and why? Actually, I'm also interested in that question, because there's also blood in fish. And from the Jewish perspective, I can say, well, fish do not have to be ritually slaughtered. Please tell me if I'm wrong. So, why not? And mammals, yeah, yes, they do. So, yes, my question goes to you, Professor Gross.
Yeah, no, thanks for this wonderful question. So, this has to do with if you will, biblical biology versus contemporary biology. So curiously, in the biblical understanding, which the rabbis and the Jewish tradition adopt, fish are not understood to have blood. They don't have blood in the same way mammals do. So blood, people should be aware, is of enormous kind of regulating. What happens to animal blood is of enormous concern in the biblical tradition, and this is seen in later kind of kosher law. There seems to be a kind of connection of blood with life itself. So indeed, it would change Jewish law enormously and have huge implications if fish were understood to have blood. It would seem to indicate that some of the same concerns we have for mammals should apply to them. But the way in which fish have been kind of understood as not actually having blood in the way it's defined in Jewish law means that fish are very easy to make, fully kosher, and that tradition has continued. It's most an interesting kind of accident as to how this has happened. Given what we now know physiologically about fish, it would seem that Jewish law should be concerned with how they're approached. And in liberal Jewish circles that are raising questions about what it means to eat ethically from a Jewish perspective, sometimes this might be called eco-kashrut. The plight of sea animals is getting tremendous and increasing kind of attention as something that previously was not thought about. Cruelty was a problem that was associated with the treatment of cattle and maybe chickens, but these days we are definitely talking about cruelty and the various ecological problems associated with fish. So a very good reason to revisit the kind of exclusion of fish from the kosher fold.
Professor Kurnas, what about Islam?
Also tatsächlich wieder sehr ähnlich. Man unterscheidet zwischen Fischen und Säugetieren.
We differentiate between fish and mammals, and we do also think that in fish you do not find the type of blood that you would find in mammals. So this relates to our sources, our authoritative sources as well. Well, actually, fish, you do not apply any kind of ritual slaughtering. Actually, you can also eat fish even though it might be swimming in the water and is dead. Well, so, probably that has something to do with the fact that water is considered pure, and therefore, you know, whatever you find in the water is considered pure, including dead fish. That is different from animals on the land. And and blood in the Muslim tradition is something that is impure. That, you know, this is why you do have to fully bleed the animals, land animals, for example, if you slaughter them. So what you would look out for is that if you had, you know, stringent provisions for the slaughtering of fish, of animals, you would have to make sure, for example, that you come up with adequate breeding requirements, because of course, you know, there's all kinds of, you know, commercial activity with fish as well. But so that animal welfare is kept in this regard. So, but yes, we too are talking about two different types of categories in this regard. One more interesting question that is also linked to a question that I would have. The industrialized production system, how should it actually be adjusted, adapted for ritual slaughtering to be done in a humane manner? Professor Kurnas, in your presentation, you really told us very nicely about the Muslim vegetarian movements that already exist. I did not know that before, I must say. But now, the Jewish perspective, we would also want to shed more light on that. Professor Kornas, actually, you already mentioned the mystics, actually, so why vegetarian meals from a Muslimic or Islamic point of view is of benefit, and why, you know, slaughtering, ritual slaughtering during pilgrimage can also be done in a metaphoric manner. But Professor Gross, my question goes to you. In the United States and United Kingdom, there are many vegetarians. There are organizations to that effect. You also mentioned one yourself. And then, you know, a vegetarian society in United Kingdom, and Jonathan Safran Foer, a Jewish author, spoke in the in his film, If This Is Kosher, about the practice of animal slaughter as practiced in some farms in the United States, which he deems to be cruel. So, therefore, this question, you know, what about the critique, this type of critique that Jonathan Safran Foer raised, what do you think about that? And is there some kind of Jewish vegetarianism based on a Jewish ethical point of view? Or after all of these discussions that we've had, well, is there any kind of change that you do see in accordance with, you know, slaughtering houses and the procedures that are applied? Something that is changing?
Thanks so much for the rich question. So a couple things there. I'm very sympathetic to the kind of critique of the industrialized meat industry offered by Jonathan Safran Foer in his book, Eating Animals. I'm actually mentioned in the book and did some work to support him on that writing project. So the systematic kind of critique of factory farming is where my sympathies lie. And indeed, that book in particular did bring a kind of critique of factory farming and encouragement to go vegetarian or vegan to Jewish communities in particular. So yes, we have a rather kind of vibrant subculture of Jewish veganism and Jewish vegetarianism. There's actually been a scholarly book that came out. This is in English, but with a series of essays exploring different aspects of this phenomena. So we have a large enough Jewish kind of vegetarian and vegan response that there not only are organizations and movements to speak to, but even secondary kind of reflection on it. And in my view, when you understand how thoroughly problematic industrial animal agriculture has become, when you discuss the issues we don't have time to, you know, get into today, questions of ownership, questions of how the animals are raised genetically, the quality of their lives, the ecological problems associated with it. When you bring all of these problems to bear, in my view, it starts to seem less persuasive to simply try to eliminate some of the worst cruelties in the system and consider that enough. So my own view, and I would not be alone, is that the kinds of problems that we see in industrial slaughter are indicative of massive problems in the way in which we raise and kill animals industrially, and that probably the most ethical response is a systematic critique, if not turning in a vegan or vegetarian direction, but to look at how we could change the entire direction of industrial agriculture, which has simply been increasing these problems with animal suffering, with ecological waste, with worker mistreatment. So there is a very good case for moving away from, I think, these kinds of attempts to critique the industrial system. However, for those who are committed to continuing to eat meat, which today means eating meat from the industrial system, there is a great deal we can do to reduce animal suffering. And in the kosher context, what this really means is having facilities which are designed to achieve a high welfare kosher slaughter. It's simple as that. If the facility has been built from the ground up with an orientation towards religious slaughter, you can have a very, from the perspective of animal welfare science, we can achieve a really high welfare slaughter. And that would be the way I think things should go. Where the problems occur is, and this is the dominant situation we have today, is you don't have plants that are dedicated to religious slaughter. You have plants that are oriented towards secular slaughter and that are modifying their operations to accommodate religious slaughter. When you are doing that, it creates a lot of challenges to achieve, you know, animal welfare. And those details become too technical to kind of discuss here. But my argument would be if you are going to be in that kind of compromised situation, you need to really be working with animal welfare experts who can help you modify that system as well as possible to address welfare. So those would be three different ways to respond. The one I'm most sympathetic with is a global critique of the system that would lean one to reduce meat or move in a vegan or vegetarian direction. The other direction is to look at reforms, but with the agenda of really achieving optimal welfare through facilities that are dedicated to religious slaughter. And the third piece would be, well, if we're in a compromised situation, how do we address achieving higher welfare, and a different set of protocols would apply there?
Vielen Dank für Ihre Antwort.
Yeah, thank you very much for your answer. I have another question. A historical question. So I will read it first in English and then translate into German.
Into slaughter, and B, when did the kosher slaughter practice get transferred into industrial slaughter system? Also, wann begann man mit der Betäubung in der Schlachtwirtschaft generell? Und das ist die Frage A. Und die Frage B ist, wann wurde das koschere Schächten, und ich denke, hier kann man gleich auch das Halal-Schächten.
She's just repeating the translation. She has done the translation in German. So first, let me turn to Professor Kornas. Can you give an answer, first of all? Well, I don't know the exact time frame. I think at the beginning of the 20th century. Because this is actually when factory farming started, and this is when the problem arose to begin with. I cannot give you really, you know, the exact time frame, but I think, you know, somewhere in the 20th century. I believe that this might be a question that does not relate specifically to the Jewish or the Islamic background, but maybe Professor Gross can mention something or say something about the American point of view in this regard.
So I apologize. I wasn't able to hear the statement in English, so I'm unclear what the historical question was.
Okay. Oh, okay. Soll ich die Frage noch mal auf Deutsch, auf Englisch? Okay, ich werde die Frage noch mal auf Englisch vorlesen.
So I will read
when
the question in English.
When did stunning get introduced in slaughter? Question A. And question B, when did the kosher slaughter practice get transferred into industrial slaughter system?
Great. Yeah, my understanding is this is the late 1800s, at least in the U.S. context. And so this simply tracks with industrialization. So key in the U.S. context, some of the key developments here include the technology of refrigeration unexpectedly. So when you had refrigerated rail cars, you could have a situation where animals were grown in a part of the country that's very efficient to grow them. You could slaughter them out there, and then you could put refrigerated meat and bring it to the cities. This started to allow the concentration of animals in particular areas, and then with additional kind of technological developments, you have, you know, ultimately a kind of assembly line fashion slaughter developed. So my understanding is this is happening in the mid to late 1800s in the U.S. context. I suspect it's quite similar in the European. And then once these industrialized kind of techniques start to get practiced, you can imagine the kind of cruelty that gets introduced when you have intensive time pressures, less professionalization than in small-scale butchery. And as the cruelty is exposed, humane advocates start to demand stunning. And that's when this process, which I tried to describe in my talk, begins of you start to design your slaughterhouse with the assumption that the animal is getting stunned and is unconscious at an early point in that procedure. And what that means is the equipment is designed such that it's doing things to the animal you wouldn't want to do to a conscious animal. So for example, shackling their legs and hoisting them into the air, which will be very painful for a heavy animal, and then moving that animal in the air along a conveyor system. These sorts of techniques, which were not a part of traditional slaughter at all, get introduced at this time. And then you can see why, if you're doing that to an animal, stunning becomes a very powerful welfare technique. And it's here where the conflict, the welfare conflict with kosher and halal begins, as they try to get access to these big slaughterhouses and essentially meet resistance around how much they're going to be modified to allow for kosher and halal slaughter.
Wenn wir jetzt schon gerade über die Betäubung
sprechen.
Yeah, so
now we are talking about stunning. And this is why I would like to read out the following question that came in from the audience. Let's say a direct question. So do you think that severing the neck without stunning, without would actually be not painful for the animal? I mean, this is suffering to the animal, is it not? So first of all, this question goes to Professor Kornas. Well, of course, the animal is suffering.
beurteilen, sondern nur wiedergeben.
But I cannot judge, I can only repeat what I heard. People that are in favor of ritual slaughtering say that it's less suffering than, for example, a captive bull chuck. So people hold this to be true because they say, okay, there are measurements that we are taking and that corroborates our finding. We do have to say, and I'm speaking on behalf of traditional slaughtering here, what is important there is that severing the trachea and the esophagus has to be done quickly, so that in, you know, a split second, actually, the animal loses its consciousness, and by fastly bleeding out, the suffering decreases. So the reason for this being that everybody is thinking in terms of reducing the suffering of the animal. So other scholars do say, okay, stunning is a possibility in order to reduce the suffering of the animal as much as possible, but there are different opinions, as we mentioned before, and there is no ultimate proof that, you know, slaughtering with prior stunning is better than slaughtering, ritual slaughtering without prior stunning. So I think it is very different to describe that procedure. I think maybe you have to measure, you know, apply measuring devices, as I mentioned before, and then see, okay, there are the values of the measuring devices. Now, how do I interpret these values? And some people hold that it is important to have traditional ritual slaughtering, regardless whether or not this is the kind of procedure that should be applied. But most of the people say that captive bull stunning is really something that is painful, and this should not be done. So we have the very traditional opinion in respect to what is written in the scripture, and then there is the other camp, let's say, the other group of people saying that whatever can be done in order to reduce the suffering of the animal has to be done, but what should be avoided is that the animal then dies before slaughtering. So reducing suffering is, of course, very important. But yes, of course, suffering is something that we will not avoid totally. Yeah. So this is why then people turn to veganism, maybe, or go vegetarian. Professor Gross, is it similar in Judaism? Are there similar explanations, or maybe some supplementary remarks that you would like to make on that point?
Yeah, no, thanks for the very direct question. So I want to, I mean, I take this to be a scientific, you know, a question about a Jewish and a Muslim practice, you know, relative to slaughter with stunning. So I'll try to say something about the science in a moment. What I think is really crucial to observe here is that if we are coming from the perspective that we want to reduce animal suffering, it would be a bad move to focus on the moment of slaughter, where a great deal of progress has already been made in terms of regulation, and where we have to deal with these very complicated social issues to make further changes. We have, throughout the life of animals raised today in industrial systems, just enormous whole areas of misery which are currently unaddressed. You know, chickens around the world are genetically disposed to all sorts of diseases and malformations, such that even if they are raised in conditions that are good, their very genetics turn their bodies into painful kinds of experiences. There's lots of places, if our aim is primarily to reduce animal suffering, that we would want to focus our policy efforts. And it would be strange to choose to try to reduce animal suffering by focusing on this particular issue for the reasons I'll explain. So to the scientific question, if we're trying to compare optimal situations, that is a kind of optimal kosher slaughter, to an optimal version of slaughter that is working with stunning, here is, I think, what we would find. With captive bolt stunning, if it works well, what's happening is a bolt is either kind of smacking their head or literally going into their skull and, you know, disrupting the brain matter and killing them. Sometimes it's referred to as stunning as actually killing the animals, which is part of the concern in kosher and Islamic law. But when a captive bolt is working properly, the animal collapses immediately and indicates immediate kind of signs of loss of consciousness. Immediate here means within a couple seconds. It means if I'm watching the procedure, I see the captive bolt go onto the animal's head, I see it fire, and the animal appears to immediately collapse. And if I verify, the animal will have lost consciousness. So that seems like a pretty good way to die. The problem is it doesn't always work like that. A certain number of times when that captive bolt fires, something goes wrong, and it doesn't render the animal unconscious, it just harms the animal. And then you have to have a secondary procedure in place for what you do in that event. If the slaughterhouse is not managed well, a captive bolt system can produce a lot of animals who are getting hit one, two, three times before they're going down. So these are the kinds of cruelty problems that can arise with a captive bolt system. But if it works well, it would be a minimal of suffering. Now, in the context of kosher slaughter, what seems to have been worked out over time is when the shechita cut is performed and the animal is calm, if it's in a situation where it's been handled in such a way that it's calm, what Temple Grandin reports, and so I'm not going on an anecdote here, I'm citing one of the most published scientists in the world on this topic. Temple Grandin reports that when done properly, the animal will not experience the cut itself. It has the effect of a paper cut. If it's done by a highly trained slaughterer, you can achieve an effect where the animal starts to feel discomfort because it's bleeding and it's losing consciousness. So I'm not saying there's no pain, but it is. It seems to be a pretty good death. What seems to happen is, in an optimal case, the animal will show no reaction to the cut. It will appear not to know that it's being cut. And then as the blood is lost, within 30 seconds, it will lose consciousness. And there is presumably some distress during that time. There isn't a scientific test I'm aware of that allows us to easily judge between these two methods. When they're done optimally, they both would be a good death, but it's not easy to do either one optimally. And that's really where welfare issues today kind of sit. That is, how do we create a system that actually makes the captive bolt function the way it's supposed to function? That would be optimal humane. Or in the case of a system using kosher halal slaughter, how do we create a system where that method of slaughter is going to lead to an animal not reacting to the cut and an animal quickly losing consciousness? So in terms of the ultimate question, you know, which is better? I don't think we have a scientific answer. Now, when we compare actual slaughterhouses, we can answer this question much more definitively. We can indeed send scientists into a particular slaughterhouse and have them measure, to some extent, the animal's distress with this system or that system. But that doesn't answer the question globally. It answers it for how that particular slaughterhouse is operating. So I don't think there is an obvious humane benefit to stunning outside of the industrial slaughter system. In the industrial slaughter system, absolutely, stunning makes a tremendous amount of sense. If you're dealing with trying to kill lots of animals at once, it's going to be very hard to create a calm situation for the animal. I mean, even as was alluded to by the other speaker, even the medieval and ancient legislators were aware of the distress that an animal can experience from seeing other animals slaughtered. How are you going to avoid this in industrial slaughter? It's there's just very tremendous, tremendously great problems with industrial slaughter. And this is where stunning really begins to be key. So I think we need to kind of understand this. Stunning is a really important victory for animal welfare, but it is fixing a problem in industrial slaughter. It is not the summit of humane achievement.
Ich habe hier vielen Dank erstmal für Ihre Antwort. Für
Thank you very much for your answers. The topic of stunning seems to be a key issue also for our viewers, because here we do have another question, a follow-up question. From a Jewish point of view, stunning because of the danger of injury is being prohibited. Is that the same for Islam as well? Or maybe the explanation is a different one. So actually, the question goes directly to Professor Gross. So let me repeat. Therefore, stunning is not allowed in Judaism because the animal can be injured. Is that the reason?
The Jewish legal reason for the prohibiting on stunning is that the animal has to be healthy and that this is determined by the animal being conscious. So if the animal has been stunned and is unconscious, Jewish law reasons, we can't tell whether it's healthy, we can't tell whether it will wake up again, and so we require that the animal be conscious. Now, a technicality here in Jewish law, the reason stunning is prohibited is not because of an inherent problem with stunning. It's because of the way in which stunning interferes with evaluating the health of the animal. So there is a possibility within Jewish law to imagine a form of, and this is where you hear discussion of reversible, you know, stunning, meaning the animal would wake up and be perfectly healthy. That form of stunning doesn't pose the same problem in Jewish law, theoretically. But in actual practice, there is, I'm aware of, it may be existing experimentally, but I'm unaware of any large-scale slaughter plant which has developed a method of verifying reversible slaughter that has satisfied kosher authorities. So the Jewish traditional reasoning against stunning has to do with this health of the animal. However, you are correct that what we've learned is that stunning can also is generally a welfare plus. I think we need to be very clear about that. Overwhelmingly, stunning is a really good thing, but it's not a perfect system. It can, if it's not done well, and even if it is done well, there's going to be a certain number of animals which don't go down properly. And so this creates an additional kind of reason to not see stunning as a kind of ultimate solution under Jewish law. But to be clear, the Jewish law itself, the rabbis who are arguing that the animal needs to be conscious are doing it on the basis of this is how we know the animal is healthy.
Professor Kurnas, Sie hatten ja Professor in Ihrem Kurnas. Vortrag
In your presentation, you also mentioned stunning. But after what Professor Gross stated. Maybe you can tell us a little bit more about your points of view from Islamic law.
Right.
Our concern, too, is that if the animal is being stunned, we cannot really know, especially with captive bolt stunning, whether or not the animal is healthy. And therefore, you know, if the animal is then, well, stunned and it dies, then, of course, the meat is unfit for human consumption. So this is why some of the scholars hold that electroshock is okay, because it does reduce the suffering of the animal, and it can be done in the slaughtering process. But in order to really make sure that the animal does not die, also these scholars recommend not to go into stunning. Those who are very much against stunning are those who do have a very literal understanding of the sources. They say, okay, it's not mentioned in the sources in the religious texts, and therefore we are not allowed to do, talk about stunning. But, well, these are theological arguments, but they say, okay, the animal is not being injured, it is healthy, and then, you know, we are fine. But the others, other groups also say, well, if we actually understand that the animal is healthy, even though there was prior stunning, it is okay as well. But we've heard, because Professor Gross actually described it, you know, that captive bolt stunning can also go wrong. And so the captive bolt stunning procedure is really something that, you know, might go wrong badly. So, of course, you know, the laceration and the cut by the knife is a different story, but we have animals suffering, all right. So, there is one more question I would like to raise, even though we do not have much time left. Actually, the relationship between man and animal has changed a lot over the past couple of decades and centuries also. Actually, you know, some people, you know, love their pets dearly nowadays, and animals to the point that they almost make them human-like. So there are even online forums for mourning the deceased pet, in which the question is raised, well, where does the soul of my cat go after death? So this is my question then, what happens with the soul of these animals after death? So my question to Professor Gross, what do you say? Does an animal have a soul from a Jewish point of view, and if so, what happens to its soul? And does the soul of a ritually slaughtered animal enjoy special privileges, maybe?
So thanks so much for raising the question of the broader relationship of humans and animals at the end here. I think that that is indeed behind so much of this conversation. Yeah, so do animals have souls? I'll tell you what I understand to be the traditional answer and offer my own gloss on it. It's very clear in the Bible, in early Jewish texts, that the created world is ensouled. The phrase "all that breathes, all that lives, all that has soul," we find these regularly in the Hebrew Bible, and they clearly include humans and other forms. Now, in the medieval period in Judaism, following in some ways dialogues that engage Christian and Muslim theologians, you have medieval Jewish theologians articulating a hierarchy of soul. And so humans are said to have, you know, a kind of higher soul. Animals have a different kind of soul, and there can be reflections on soul and other forms of matter. But in that theology, you have this strong separation kind of imagined between human and animal souls. The direction if I'm looking at the idea in the Bible, where there seems to be a strong sense of the entire created world mattering, and soul or the divine spirit kind of is moved through everything. As we see in later rabbinic thought, there seems to be greater emphasis on the elevation of the human, on, in this way, talking about humans having a special soul. Though it's never denied that animals have a soul, as has happened in some other traditions. I mean, I think this theological language is a way we wrestle with our relationship with the non-human world. Today, we're more aware, I think, than ever that something has gone wrong in how human beings are relating to the natural world, relating to the environment, relating to animals. And I think that trajectory in religious thought that we see of moving us away from some of these ideas of where the whole of creation is valued. We have moved away from those ideas for some time, historically speaking, but perhaps now we're moving back towards those ideas, recognizing how powerful it is to see religious value, not only in other human beings, but in the created world. And that would certainly be the direction, at least, that I hope theological thought continues. So thank you for that question.
Professor Kurnas, gibt es im Islam
are there similar explanations in Islam about the soul of an animal and its whereabouts after death? Yes, there are parallels to this, especially, for example, in terms of some of the religious texts. Of course, for example, a Muslim philosopher is actually making that distinction between animal soul and human soul. Others hold, okay, animals do not have a soul at all. But no, the majority actually state that, yes, there are different types of souls, and this is the opinion that, or these are the opinions that we do find in our discussions. And the ritually slaughter animals, there is a sacrificial animal. The animal is killed, it has a soul, but the prophet actually also mentions that, well, the animal is actually also being resurrected, and if somebody is hitting, the animal hard and is abusing the animal after resurrection of the soul, it is then a punishment on the person who has done wrong that can be applied. So we do believe that new kinds of thinking is appearing, and people do hold nowadays that, there are not major differences between the human being and the animal soul, and this is also part of the mystic tradition, whether we are talking about the tree trunk or an animal or the human being, we all have to respect each other, and the expressions in the Quran that the animals or the other creatures are dominated by human beings. Well, but the human being then has special responsibility over the other creatures. So, because the human being is then using that to his own benefit, the animals, the other creatures in this world, and therefore carries major responsibility. So handling nature means we have to be responsible, we have to be careful. We do not have dominion over the other creatures. There is a kind of rethinking of that you know, statement that we know of, and we have to be very careful in treating the creation correctly and responsibly. Well, yes, thank you very much. This is very good. You know, we are talking about responsibility here. And we are coming to an end, and I would like to apologize vis-a-vis the viewers because we are running out of time, and I cannot really, unfortunately, take on any other question. Nevertheless, let me raise one more question, a final question. What do you wish for the future of Jewish and or Muslim rituals? Slaughtering, you know, the future of it. What can the religious communities do better, and what can our societies do better? This is my final question to the two of you. First, let's start with Professor Gross, please.
Thanks for that. What I would hope is that you know, the Jewish community, the Muslim community, can really become forces for advancing animal welfare, and bring the long wisdom traditions that they carry about compassion for animals to kind of bear on the industrial system. What that would mean is moving from a kind of defensive stance. Where we've ended up is because of this history of anti-Semitism, and I'm including here both anti-Jewish and anti-Muslim sentiments. There's been energy spent kind of trying to defend the right, the ability to do religious slaughter. It's not a very exciting position to be in. What I think is possible is moving from that defensive stance to really recognize that industrial slaughter maybe is not something that was so exciting to be a part of in the first place, that this is a pretty problematic system, and that the energy in the Jewish and Muslim communities could be used to create alternative systems. I mentioned, you know, dedicated slaughter facilities that would be optimally designed. If there is going to be ongoing meat eating in the Jewish community, which seems likely, even though I'm inclined myself in a vegan direction, that would be my hope, that we turn the tables and activate the tradition of compassion for animals to really become a positive force in actively developing a better and more humane systems. That'd be my hope.
Professor Kurnas?
Ja, meine Hoffnung geht in dieselbe Richtung.
Also yes, I share that hope. There are two things that I would hope for, you know, reducing meat consumption, for one, and then, of course, you know, an improvement of animal husbandry conditions. And then also, in terms of Islamic tradition, find, you know, an alternative. Don't actually provide halal certificates only, because they don't provide an alternative. You know, it's only something that that is something that is not enough. We have similar certificates in banking. You know, then in Muslim banking, people say, "Oh, we don't offer or we don't charge any interest rates," but it's you know, not true. It is actually something that is integrated in the price that is being offered. So, I mean, this is something that really needs to change in Muslim tradition. And we have to understand where the perils lie, where the dangers are in industrial farming, in factory farming, and concentrate and focus more on the alternatives. Not an easy way to follow, but I think this is groundbreaking endeavor, and I think it's an opportunity that we have. And we have to think along these lines. What can we do better in order to actually also change things. For example, in the German context and the German society, we have to be able and be prepared to spend more on food, for example. You know, we think, oh, 1 euro and we have whatever, a kilo of meat. No, well, what can we expect then? And if you have that wrong type of expectation, it really does not matter which traditional background you come from, but this is something that needs to actually change. And I believe that the religious communities, be the Jewish communities or Muslim communities, can actually be a model, a pioneer also, in order to improve the situation in animal husbandry, in meat production, in the creation as a whole. Well, thank you so very much. That was really an excellent closing. Actually, there was a question, actually a comment.
Great lectures, great answers from both speakers. Thank you. I learned a lot. Also, wunderbare Vorträge.
So, wonderful presentations, great answers. That is a comment that one of the viewers made. Well, I think this is great feedback, I believe, for the two of you. So, thank you very much. This brings me to the end of our event tonight. I would like to tell the viewers that we are going to have a next session on the 22nd of June at 1900 hours, so 7 o'clock in the evening, on the topic of between sanction and sanctification, alcohol in Judaism and Christianity. So thank you so very much, Aaron Sol Gross and Professor Sarah Kurnas. And thank you very much also and to our interpreters Astrid Geser and Güda Turo and our cameraman Peter Wollring and our technicians of Art Lights and Stefan van Zwoll from our event management department. So thank you very much. Have a great evening.